death! I'm melting! Melting! Oh, what a world! What a world!
Yeah, I bet that's how Greenland feels at the moment. Because she was also green. I'll be honest, it's all I could find. So this week we're having a look at what's going on in the Arctic and how climate change has already radically altered how people live up there. So we're going to scrub another couple of words off the WTF board and go outside for a minute. So up here is the Arctic Ocean, which gets most of the news when it comes to sea ice melting and positive feedback loops and all of that. The Arctic is an ocean surrounded by landmass and covered in sea ice to a greater or lesser extent, depending on the time of year. If we just nudge the globe around to the other pole, we get to Antarctica. Antarctica is a completely different kettle of fish. Rather than being an ocean surrounded by landmass, Antarctica is a continental landmass surrounded by ocean. The landmass itself is covered in ice sheets hundreds of meters thick. And because the ice sits on land and not water, it's far less affected by seasonal variations. And until recently, it was thought to be rock solid and stable. Now though, scientists are beginning to realize that that's not the case. We'll take a more detailed look at Antarctica next week, but this week we're going to focus on the Arctic Ocean and the really terrifying levels of sea ice loss that scientists are beginning to track there. Scientists have been tracking Arctic sea ice levels since the mid part of the 20th century. And over the 40 years since NASA's satellites first started taking measurements of the area, there's been a strong downward trend. During the winter months, it's hard to see how the Arctic could be missing any ice at all, given that it extends to about 1.5 times the area of Canada. But these yellow lines show the boundary of the ice from 1978, and NASA reckons the Arctic's lost an area of ice equivalent to twice the size of France since then. In fact, the four lowest winter coverages of sea ice have been the last 4 years. As the Arctic ice melts away, there's less white surface available to reflect the sun's rays back out to space. It's really as basic as that. Although scientists do still put a poncy name on it, they refer to sunlight reflection as albedo. This in turn results in a positive feedback loop. And I don't mean positive in a positive way. It actually contributes to another poncily titled scientific phenomenon, Arctic amplification. In other words, less ice, less reflection, and more heat absorbed by dark liquid water means more heat in the Arctic to melt more ice, which means the Arctic's getting a dangerously low albedo, and nobody wants one of them. It's during the summer months that the decrease is most obvious. Climatologists have measured a reduction in sea ice area more than twice that of the winter, and they're now talking about a completely ice-free summer Arctic Ocean very soon. It no longer seems to be a question of if, but when. The most vocal climate scientists are suggesting we may see an ice-free Arctic Ocean as soon as the summer of 2020, with others suggesting 2030 as a more likely timescale. Sea ice melting doesn't actually raise sea levels because it's already in the water, but the warming feedback loop is increasing the temperature of the oceans, and when water gets warmer, it expands, and this does raise the sea levels. But the biggest threat coming from the Arctic region is the rapid melting of land-based ice sheets now being witnessed in Greenland. Greenland is the world's biggest island, and 3/4 of it is covered in an ice cap that holds 8% of the entire planet's fresh water. From north to south, the ice sheet is 2,700 kilometers long, it's 1,500 kilometers wide, and up to 3,500 meters thick. It's so big that it'll most likely never melt away completely, but the rapid changes in its surface are enough to significantly affect the global environment. NASA reckons that Greenland loses 30 billion more tons of ice every year. As the melting ice hits the ocean, it becomes saline and we lose more and more of one of the Earth's precious freshwater stores. And unlike sea ice, when land-based ice melts, we also get a rise in global sea levels, which has already started to jeopardize the low-lying countries and some of the major coastal cities of the world. There's actually enough ice sitting on top of Greenland to raise global sea levels by 7 meters. Climate change and global warming is more than scientific conjecture in Greenland, it's become a way of life that the inhabitants are having to learn about and adapt to, and there are winners and losers as a result. The farmers of Greenland were initially able to take advantage of the warmer summers to grow a wider range of crops commercially, but in recent years they've been suffering droughts and prolonged insect attacks during the summer months, in a way that's not been seen before. Greenland's fishermen look like being the biggest winners from climate change, at least in the medium term. The melt brings fresh water full of nutrients down from the ice caps into the fjords and the waters surrounding the country, and fish like mackerel are migrating up to the warming waters of the Arctic in a way they've never done before. Mackerel is a warm water species, not normally found in temperatures colder than 8 degrees Celsius. The first mackerel ever caught in Greenland waters was in 2011. And by 2014, 85,000 tonnes were landed, which represented about 24% of the total national fisheries export of Greenland. But as technology has improved the way the ice is measured, the biggest shock to scientists has been how quickly the ice thickness is also decreasing. NASA has been flying planes in a straight line down the Helheim Glacier on the east side of Greenland for over 20 years, firing out several thousand pulses of laser light 250 meters in diameter every second as it completes its flight path along the glacier's length. This is the actual topological map produced from NASA's 1998 flight as it made its way down to the calving point, which is where icebergs shear off into the sea as part of what used to be a normal cycle of movement and replenishment. If we then overlay, or more accurately underlay, the same flight from 2013, it shows quite clearly not only that the height of the ice is dramatically different, but also that you would have had to have travelled back 2.5 miles to get to the 2013 calving point, and that if you'd been physically able to stand on the lower 2013 level of these two glacial conveyor belts back in 1998, you would have had over 100 metres of solid ice above your head. So Greenland is a portent of what's coming to the rest of the planet in the next few years, particularly if we continue our sleepwalking, business-as-usual approach, increasing the amount of carbon dioxide going into the atmosphere year on year, instead of reducing it. A global rise in sea levels doesn't just mean a few hundred million people have to move inland, although that will be devastating for the individuals and the local economies involved. It also impacts on freshwater availability and the global food supply chain. Ultimately, it's going to hit the global economy, and eventually it'll catch up with the wealth and privilege that we currently enjoy in the West. Thankfully, as well as being the stupidest species that's ever lived on this planet, we're also the smartest and most resourceful. The technologies that are enabling renewable energy and that are building sustainable cities and infrastructure around the world are moving at an exponential rate at the moment, as the economies of scale have taken on a truly unstoppable momentum over the last few short years. Nevertheless, I'm going to keep banging the drum about the small changes each of us can make in our own lives, and I found a couple of products this week that I'm going to put into my own home. This is a set of remote control sockets from a company called Energini that I got online. You get 4 sockets and a remote control, all for about 20 quid. Leaving stuff on standby actually costs a significant amount of electricity. It's estimated that the average family probably wastes, funnily enough, about 20 quid a year doing that. Doesn't sound a lot, but there's 26 million homes in the UK alone, so that's over half a billion quid wasted just in this country. Here's a list of the top 10 countries in the world by number of households, and we're only just scraping in 10th place. So globally, the savings from devices like this are astonishing. Get yourself one of these in each room, plug it into your remote control switch, and plug all your devices into it. Then switch the whole lot off remotely whenever you leave the room. By the way, it also saves you bending down to reach those awkward sockets. This one couldn't be simpler. It's called a hippo bag, and it costs a couple of quid, again, off the internet. Now, I'm definitely behind the curve on this thing, because apparently since its launch in 1997, they've sold about 11 million of these things, saving the equivalent of 30 Olympic-sized swimming pools of water every day, which they calculate to be equal to 65,000 tonnes of CO2 saved each year. If, apparently like 90% of UK homes, you've got an older lav that uses a ball cock, it's a proper word, then you put the bag in your cistern underneath that. If you've got a European style toilet, you just put the bag in the free space next to the gubbins. Push the bag down and make sure it's full of water, and then flush the loo. As the cistern fills up, keep filling the bag up with water from a jug, and don't worry, you've only got to do that bit once. After that, each time you flush, you're saving water. Easy pie. Right, that's it for this week. Don't forget to share the link with your friends, and if you haven't already done so, hit the red subscribe button below to get notified whenever a new video comes out. As always, thank you very much for watching, have a good week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.